No? No questions? No questions? Any questions? Yeah. Yes, we can. Thank you, Dan. Thank you. Yeah.
So, when we come to this conceptual understanding of the next
yeah. Yeah, yeah. Familiarize yourself with it until it's deeper and deeper. Because you see, what's happening, if you think conceptually, what's happening is we might get a flash, we might get a sense, even sitting here listening, we'll go, oh, yeah, I get it. But it's gone in a millisecond, isn't it? We're back to the default mode of grasping. So that's what the old habit is. Like, you're so used to seeing it as red, you for a second get it that it's not, but it goes straight back to seeing it as red again. So you've got to keep doing the logical arguments to break that down. And that insight, seeing the absence of the inherent eye gets deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper until eventually it's a completely non-conceptual, irreversible one and you can never go back from there on. It's just perfecting it, like playing piano. You get it first. Wow, great, I just did it, you know. But then you make a mistake again. You've got to do it and do it and do it until you get it. It's completely spontaneous in you. That's what a genuine experience of it is. And it's just practice. And what you're practicing is continuously thinking, using the logical arguments, which is the stuff that you're thinking about, which triggers the insight. Obviously, the more you've got concentration, the deeper your concentration, the more focused your mind, the more refined your mind, the more subtle it is, the more subtle is the analysis. Do you understand? Don't understand. I mean, conceptual can be very subtle. And the more powerful the insight, and then eventually irreversible. Do you understand? Yeah.
Is it possible to give us a couple of examples of what our experience would be like if we got it?
Emptiness, yeah. You'd be fearless. You wouldn't have attachment. I mean, when you really got it, you wouldn't have attachment, you wouldn't have anger, because they are all the consequences of grasping at the inherent I. So when you've finally seen the absence of the inherent I, and I mean really certain stages of development, I don't know exactly, doesn't matter what level, but as you progress, eventually no attachment, no anger, no depression, no fear, no anxiety, no worries, no full of love, full of kindness, this is it. All that's left more and more as you grow and grow is only the virtues. So it's bliss, joy, wisdom, clairvoyance, happiness, love, compassion, fearlessness, all the marvelous qualities getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, happier and happier and happier and nicer and nicer and nicer. That's how it would be. And that's a progression, isn't it? We can even see now the bit of practice we have done. We're slightly nicer. We're not quite as angry because we've got a little bit of control over our bodies and speech. You understand what I'm saying? This will keep getting better. That's the consequence of giving up the delusions. Happier, wiser, kinder, more loving, more compassionate. It's a progression, you know? Do you understand? But the key factor, it's nice to hear this because fear... They say it in all the teachings, but it's sort of glossed over a bit. Whereas we really like to hear that because fear is such a major role in our lives. Most people don't talk about fear, but in the West we're really full of it because we've got so many delusions. We're in such a crazy world with so many objects and so many lives and so much intellectual stuff that fear is really very rampant, and most of the mental illnesses are all based on anxiety and panic. And look at us. So fear is a very big one for us, and I think it's really important we keep stressing that the nature of all the delusions is that they're based in fear, because the ego grasping is the personification of fear. You know, we talk about instinct for survival, which is when, basically Buddha would like that phrase. That's when ego grasping, which is the colloquial term for grasping at the inherent I, when that is attacked, when you come on, someone attacks you, insults you, offends you, you nearly have a car crash, you're weak at the knees, you're panicking, the heart's beating, you're nearly fainting that's what fear is. And that's when this ego grasping rises strongly, because the eye has been attacked. So that's there all the time. And the variations of it's being attacked is when you don't get what you want, when someone hurts you, when you get angry, you get jealous. It's always like constantly like moments of fear and panic. They're all rooted in this fear. It's fascinating to look at this and to really get the point here. And that the virtuous states of mind are the opposite. They're spacious and appropriate and fearless and calm and peaceful and blissful. They're not based in fear or anything. And so instinct for survival is a great term for grasping at the eye. You understand? Hang on, sweetheart.
I'm kind of nervous to ask
this question, but... I won't shout, I promise.
Huh? To me last year. And then
okay, can I stop for a second?
Yes.
If you're going to talk about a personal experience, it's kind of maybe not appropriate. Well, you should keep these things private if they're okay. Special experiences. No, it was just something to ask a question out of, is it?
It is.
Okay, good, done. Good,
so
good, good, good.
When I was here for the Heart Sutra retreat, it taught me that I can understand that as not...
Understand what?
The emptiness of the... Like you had talked about actually in the retreat, the idea of victimization.
Okay.
Where I struggled in my meditation since is I feel like I got it and I was able to grasp it or understand the emptiness in that and the experience of letting that go to not have those non-virtuous states of mind.
The anger and the hurt and resentment and the self-pity and all that stuff, you mean?
Yeah, right. Exactly. And
right,
really
right. Good, good, good.
But as I've progressed with that,
yes.
I slip back into
of course we do, that's right.
It's been really much more painful, I think,
there you go.
Than the first experience.
I understand. Because, yes. I understand. I know. That's a that's the mistake. That's the mistake. Not the fact that you're slipping back. Because when you got it first, sometimes it's very exciting. We can think we've now, oh, wow, I got it. But that's the mistake. You didn't get it. You just got a glimpse of it. So then you're disappointed when you fall back. But if you didn't realize, if you really didn't expect to not fall back, you wouldn't be disappointed because it's natural to fall back because you didn't get it yet. So all these misconceptions about you should be, you're thinking you're further than you are, you should be further than you are, oh my God, I'm disappointed. All that's all nonsense. It's one step at a time, baby. Sometimes we can get little flashes and it can be very nice. Delight in that. Grab hold of it. Remember the taste of it. Bring it back later. And you've got to keep perfecting it. It's like you get to play the piano the first time and you got it. Oh, wow, I've got it. I can't believe. It was the first time you got into the zone and you played it beautifully. But then suddenly you play it next time and you can't believe you make all these mistakes again because you haven't perfected it yet. That's what I mean about just keeping going. Remember that time. It's very nice. We can get great taste. We can get really powerful experiences of compassion sometimes. But it's not stable yet. We can't do it every time because we haven't perfected it yet. Do you see the simple point I'm making?
Yes.
Okay.
Pardon?
Sweetheart. Sweetheart. The very function of this ignorance in our mind has been making up nonsense for eons. So purification are the practices that put atomic bombs under that nonsense to remove all the junky weeds, a little baby bit, so you can begin to put little new fragile seeds in. Of course you have to purify. It's a crucial part of your practice. You can't progress very far if you don't do the purification practices. Do you understand the concept psychologically? I don't think you do. You're nodding doubtfully. What do I mean by that, simply, psychologically?
That once I get it, I can't go back.
No, darling, I'm not saying that. Okay, that's a good question, so thank you very much. So listen, this is the function. Hang on a tick. Let me just say this purification business. The root delusion, the Buddha calls it maripa, ignorance. Okay, very broad word. Very specific function here. Ignorance fundamentally to the true nature of how things exist. That means to say interdependent arising and emptiness. This is how things exist conventionally and ultimately. Okay, so here it simply. We're ignorant of that. But that's, you see, okay, so that's regular ignorance. So again, I'll use the same example. Let's say, you know, you say to me, what's that? And I'll go, I don't know. Now that's ignorance, right? Isn't it ignorance? But isn't that simple to fix? Because I don't have anything in my mind about, I have a big blank hole. And you fill it with the word, it's a clock. And I have no resistance to that. And I'll say, oh, you're great, it's a clock. You're with me, people. This is ignorance. Now you listen. If we had this ignorance of merely not knowing how things existed, if we merely had the ignorance of a big hole in there, then all you've got to say is, oh, you don't exist inherently. You're really actually this. And we'll go, oh, thank you. That will be a perfect realization. It wouldn't take long to get, would it? So why do you think it takes a long time to get it? Because this ignorance doesn't only not know how things do exist, it's made up a load of garbage about how we think we exist. So that stuff is the mountain that has to be moved out of the way. We can't see that because it's all at the level of assumption. These deeply ingrained fantasies about how things exist, which is the exact opposite of how they exist. So we've got to move those lies out of the way. We've got to move those misconceptions out of the way. Can you get the idea? So we can be some space to fill in the truth. You with me? That's why you need purification. You know, the actual job of being a Buddhist is like I'm saying it. is being your own therapist. Learning to concentrate, learning about your mind, learning the model of the mind, identifying the delusions, arguing with them, seeing how they're liars, and eventually seeing the truth. That's easy, but you can't begin to do this, actually, until you've done masses of purification, created masses of merit, which is the function in our practice called the preliminary practices, nondro. That's what the function of those is. It's a bit like, and I use a simple analogy, please hear the point here. You know, I use this all the time. I go to Michael Jordan, and I know he's an old-fashioned example. He's probably a grandfather by now, and he's probably a new model of a best basketballer, but I don't know anybody but Michael Jordan. So I go to Michael Jordan, I've been to basketball, and I see that you get the ball in the hoop. That's the point of basketball, wouldn't you agree? Getting as many balls in the hoop as possible. And I go, oh, that looks great, I'd like to do that. Please, Michael, show me how to get the ball in the hoop. It looks easy, right? Then he will say, well, I want you to go off for 10 years and lose 50 pounds of weight and get some muscles and maybe get younger if you can and learn to all about balls and learn about teams and the particular strategies of all the basketball teams and go to university and study this and this and this and do five years of jogging. And I'll say, Michael, you didn't hear me. How do I get the ball in the hoop? And he'll proceed to answer the same question in the same way. So he says, go off and do some preliminary practices for years because then you're ready to be able to do what looks so simple. Get the ball in the hoop. Can you hear the point?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So getting the ball in the hoop here is changing your mind. Mm. Sounds easy. And it's very good to hear that. We need to be inspired that that is the job. Changing the way your ridiculous thoughts think so you can get in sync with reality. Are you with me? Mm-hmm. Being your own therapist. And it's encouraging to hear this. But, you know, you can't just go off and do it. You've got to be prepared. Your mind's got to, and we're stubborn as rocks. We're full of garbage and rubbish and ego and fantasy and nonsense. We're overexcited. We're all hysterical and ridiculous. We can't possibly begin to work on our minds. So we've got to do a bit of purifying, a bit of jogging, a bit of, you know, going back to the basics and doing really strong preliminary practices where we, quotes, purify the mind and, quotes, create merit, which is getting you ready, priming you to be able to then get realizations when you do the actual job. Can you hear that? This is why it's so hard. So just keep working, babe. And as I said to you, as Lama Zopa said, I read it recently somewhere, if you're going to choose one practice, choose purification. Very interesting point. Okay, where's that question? Yes, Mark.
In moments of when the bad roommates come out of, you know, a moment of just rage, anger, or whatever.
That's right.
I don't know if after being a practitioner as long as you have, if that still happens to you, but my question is, do you have any trick that conjures up that a remembrance of, that...
Mark, the answer to that's really simple, and it's a bit disappointing answer. You listen to it. You're a bit like saying to me, when I'm driving on the freeway and I'm about to crash, what will I do? Now, doesn't the answer absolutely depend on how much skill you have as a driver, which means how long have you been driving, how many little tools in your toolkit. If you're the first time you're ever on the freeway, I would suggest there's virtually nothing you can do except damage control and hope you don't die. But if you've been driving for 30 years and you're a really skillful driver, you've got a bucket loads of tools you can apply. The same answer here. It's all a question of how skillful you are, how much practice you've done. You understand? And the point eventually is, Mark, as we keep progressing, as we keep practicing, the point is you'll be seeing the anger coming. You'll be seeing that accident coming well before it's too late. That's the real skill, but we can't say that we're at that place yet. If it still gets out the mouth before we're ready, then that shows we're not skillful enough. So we have to have egg on our face and sit down and regret it and look at where we're at and vow to try and change it and learn to see our anger before it gets to the mouth. And that just takes practice. You see what I'm saying?
I do.
Does it answer your question?
It does. I suppose I'm trying to find a shortcut into something that really...
There isn't one.
Yeah.
There isn't one. You have to know where you're at, know how much control you have over your angry words. Angry thoughts is another thing. Not having angry words is already miraculous. If you can be aware enough, so the skills again, apart from all the purifying and all getting ready, actual technical skills at the time, like getting the ball in the hoop, you have your foot here, your foot there, the hand here, the ball there, they're the skills. The skills here are you've got to know what your mind is. You've got to be able to recognize the angry roommate and how it's talking. its words, what it's saying, how it's a misconception. You've got to be aware enough from some concentration that you've looked into your mind in the past and you can hear its thoughts before it rumbles and explodes like Vesuvius. The more you do this, the more you are capable in the midst of a situation to be skillful. So slowly, slowly. We learn about where we're at, how far it is before we go, before we lose the plot. We just have to, and we keep progressing, keep progressing, keep progressing, keep progressing, keep progressing. Most of us, the best we can do is after vomiting out the words, we've got to sit down and analyse it then, which is painful, of course. But we have to. What went wrong? How come I didn't put my foot in the brake at the right time? How come I didn't anticipate it? How come I didn't see it? What do I have to learn better? Move the gears better, learn to manoeuvre better, learn to do this better, learn to be aware better. All these things. Learn from our mistakes instead of guilt and shame and beat myself up. That's how you learn next time you bring those skills to the next situation. Meanwhile, keep purifying, keep practicing, keep doing the other practices which prime your mind, which might look evident that they're helping you see your anger, but they are. Do you see what I'm saying? So maybe one thing you've got to see is if you didn't get the ball in the hoop this time, you've got to realise you've got to do more jogging. Not just keep bashing your head against a brick wall. Maybe you've got to realise you've got to do more purification practices. So it'll help purify at a deeper level so that you're enabled at the time to watch what's happening, even to avoid it. There's many factors involved, actually. Do you see? All right. Anyone else? Any questions? Yes, yes, my dear. Yes, Rebecca. Yes, yes, John. Okay, darling.
And my problem is I never seem to get the ball in the hoop.
Sweetheart, I think you probably do.
Well, I've been doing breath meditation for quite a long while.
Well, that's why you don't.
Okay.
So you're kind of, okay, let me say, watching the breath is a bit like just bouncing the ball, bouncing and bouncing and bouncing, hoping something will come. You've got to do a little bit more, working on the muscles and doing the jogging and doing the diet and learning all the strategies. You've got to be a little bit more sophisticated in your practice. That means you've got to, the Tibetan Buddhist one would say you've got to use practices that relate to the Buddhas. They are so powerful. You've got to do some purification practices, do some prostrations. This is what the Buddhas, Tibetan Buddhists would say. Because they're related to the Buddha, they have so much more power from your mind. Sweetie, you could watch your breath till the cows come home. Nothing much will really change, with respect. This is the Tibetan Buddhist approach, that using the Buddhas, they are so potent, so powerful. Any practices we do in relation to them is like a massive atomic bomb on the junk. Then you put your breathing in that context, then it will bring some result.
Okay, I had been told.
Depends on who your sources are. Everyone says something different.
That I'm supposed to keep watching the breath until such time as my mind quieted.
Of course.
Well, my mind never quieted.
Precisely, because you haven't done enough purification. You keep waiting for the bouncing as if you're going to... If you're 40 pounds overweight, bouncing the ball isn't enough. You've got to go lose weight and go on a special diet. So then you're doing something which is one of the many tools, but it's got to be in the bigger... It's got to be one of the bigger toolkits, all the other tools as well. Lose the weight, get the strategies, learn the philosophies, deal with the teammates... Do you see what I'm saying? And that's all the purification practices. The Tibetan Buddhist one would say, using the Buddha, doing mantra, doing your prostrations, doing your water bowls. We have to look into these, but they are said to be super powerful because they're relating to the Buddhas and they hugely purify the mind. You've got to do the four powers every night, regret the negativity, vow never to do again, live in vows. This is a stupendous way to create merit. All of this makes it easier, such that if when you do watch your breath, combined with all the other tools, you'll start to see better results, more results. Can you get the point?
Yeah, I feel like I've been given permission.
Good, darling. You have permission. Okay. Rebecca.
Well, before lunch, I remember you said, when you really get the emptiness, it's going to be a horrifying experience.
It can be. For some people, it can be like shocking and fearful. Because you've seen the absence of what you thought you was existed for so long. It can be quite shocking. Then it will pass and you'll see the truth. But it's shocking and that's a good sign. It can be a good sign.
So you're talking about the moment you get that emptiness.
The moment you first see it, yeah. The absence of that eye, yeah.
Later on.
Oh, yeah, you calm down. You don't stay fearful forever. No, of course not. It's a good indicator. Absolutely. Even better sign would be when you first see emptiness, you completely bliss out. You think it's the best thing you've ever found since ever. That's the best sign. The most advanced, sharpest, wisest minds get that result.
May I ask, do you have that?
No, darling, I do not, absolutely. I'm very clever with my words. but I'm just still trying to see it, you know. But words are also can be very powerful. Intellectual understanding is very beneficial, as long as we have a sincere wish to want to make it experiential. You know, haven't had the fear thing yet. I'm still so believing in my eye. Believe me, I'm fearless, but for the wrong reason. I believe so strongly in the eye that I feel it can conquer anything, but it's wrong view.
Yeah.
Believe me.
Then you're just too humble.
No, 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 no way, not me. That's a fact. Okay, people, what else? Any questions? Yes.
I had a question going back to the feminine rising.
Yep.
Is it right to say that it is a mechanism that things exist conventional? By which things exist conventional? Is that a good way to define it?
Say it again, in another way, please. So first of all, what do you mean by dependent? Okay, what do you mean by dependent arising?
Well, I'm trying to understand what dependent arising means.
What do you think it means?
What I just said.
Say it.
It's the mechanism. It's the way in which things, a cup,
yeah,
chair, whatever,
yeah,
can exist conventionally.
Precisely. That's exactly. It's a term for that. It's how things exist conventionally. If they're made of parts, there's bunches of things come together. First, they depend in existence. They exist in dependence upon causes and conditions. You agree? Then, the more subtle level, they exist in dependence upon their parts. And subtle dependent arising, which is the level that Lama ever teaches at, is that they exist in dependence upon mind labeling them that. They're the three levels of dependent arising. Yeah. And it's the king of logics, as Lama Yeshe says, to prove that they are empty of existing inherently. Yeah, because
that's the ultimate truth.
Yeah, it leads to that. And then finally, when you know them, they mean the same thing. Dependent arising. Okay, interdependence is things exist in dependence upon various factors is a way of saying dependent arising. That proves that things exist, that things don't exist independently. So things existing interdependently means they don't exist independently. Well, that's all. Emptiness, dependent arising, same. Now the way for us are the opposites, because we've got the two extreme views. As soon as we hear emptiness, we hear nihilism. Gone too far out. As soon as we hear dependent arising, we think, great, something exists. We just put too much. Here we put too much, then we put nothing, we put too little. We've got to bring them together into the middle way. They mean the same thing. It's very tasty there. Do you understand? Okay, good. Okay, yes.
So just to reiterate,
yes.
Dependent arising means the same thing.
Yeah, different ways of seeing it, different ways of seeing things existing, different ways of speaking it, put it that way. The role initially is that you think about dependent arising, which is the nuts and bolts of things, to prove emptiness. It's the method you use to trigger the insight into their emptiness. Do you see? Okay, good. So what's interesting here is it's easy to think about nouns. You know, it's easy to think about flowers and cups and toys and goods and bads as being not inherently existent. But when you take a sentence like, I am walking up the road, I am walking up the hill, well, we have to analyse how that is empty of existence from its own side as well. So how would you do that? Well, I, which is a name given to these parts, is, which is a name we give to the verb, is walking, the name we give to the word moving your feet in front of the other. Up means up. The hill means a pokey bit. So every one of those is a dependent arising. The whole experience of I'm walking up the hill is a dependent arising. All of it is dependent upon names, causes, conditions, parts. Therefore, there is no I am walking up the hill from its own side. So everything that exists. We think of simple things like roses and, you know, cups and toilets or eyes. But everything. You're a really naughty person. There's a completely dependent arising. Yeah, you write a book unpacking those conceptions there, all the assumptions in that, how, you know, all the assumptions packed into that sentence, what each of those phrases, those words mean, where they come from, how each of them is a dependent arising, how therefore there is no you are a naughty person from its own side. Everything's like that. In the Heart Sutra, you know, it says we have to repeatedly analyse all the phenomena that exist, which is all the Heart Sutra is stating, is the various categories of phenomena. The categories, it's the way of Buddha's breaking down the universe into its component parts. So in the West, we call it atoms or this or that, all these different labels, you know. For the Buddha, the labels are the five aggregates, the four noble truths, the four noble truths, the 12 links, the 18 constituents, the this, the this, the this, and the that. And all those phenomena mentioned in the Heart Sutra are every phenomenon that exists. And this is what Buddha is saying. That's why just to think of emptiness of one thing is not enough. We have to analyze every phenomenon and seeing how it is empty of existing from its own side. Repeatedly, as it says there, you know, all the phenomena. So that everything that exists, we posit, I'm walking up a hill. Conventionally, you've got to prove what that is. Label, name it, believe in that, and then analyze how there's no inherent nature. And how you do that is by breaking it down into its component parts, for example, you know. But the subtlest one, the deepest one, the best one, the subtle dependent arising, is it's merely labeled. I am walking up the hill. Or I'm eating lunch. That's more powerful because it's got some real meaning for us. I'm eating lunch. There's not an atom of anything in there that exists inherently. Mm-hmm. We call it that. We have certain meanings. We put certain meanings onto this. Good, bad, special, something, this, need it, don't need it, it's important, blah, all the stuff. Every single atom of it is merely labeled. Merely labeled. Everything that exists is merely labeled that. Meaning the mind calls it that. The mind you define it. You label it. You define it. You make sure it does exist conventionally. Then you analyze, you look for the real inherent I am eating lunch in each component of that experience. Because an experience, I'm eating lunch, that's a noun. The experience of I'm eating lunch. It, like everything, has no inherent nature. Does exist. You are eating lunch. You can't argue with that. But not from its own side. There's no I am eating lunch from its own side. It's a merely labeled phenomenon. All the meaning we pack into it, the oceans of meaning we put into that. As soon as I say I'm eating lunch, you know, I ring up and I say, can I talk to you? No, I'm eating lunch. It's like a silent language. If you didn't know what it meant, I'd say, oh, that's great, you're eating lunch, I'm happy. So meanwhile, I'll keep talking. I'm eating lunch, Robina. I don't get the point because we have all these meanings into I'm eating lunch. It could be get, it could be good. If you're an anorexic, you're eating lunch, I should go, wow, amazing. But I don't know that. There's so many meanings we put into it. We put into the meanings and then we believe in those meanings. And then when we learn each other's language, and then we can get the shorthand. When you say I'm eating lunch, I ring you up. Ring you later. Boom, put the phone down. Because I know what you mean by it. But I won't. It's not inherent in I'm eating lunch. It could mean something else. But we give it meaning. Everything is, we give it meaning. Everything. And then we get familiar with that meaning and then we buy into that meaning. And that's how come we can communicate. That's how come we can not have communication. It's all just sounds coming out the mouth, words, on phenomena that have no inherent existence that we over eons have created and given meaning to. So when you say, hit me in the nose, I'm supposed to feel sad because we assume it's bad. Now, if I was telling you about my kung fu class, and I'm talking about a boy who never gets to hit people properly, and then I tell you, oh, he hit me in the nose. You know all that information. And you go, oh, I'm so happy for him, you'd say. But depends on the meaning. And that's the meaning you give it, because we know that meaning. So everything's to do with meaning. We give everything meaning. We think it exists inherently. It doesn't. There's nothing that exists inherently. It's got meaning. We have to know the words, know the meanings. That's what merely labeled means. Everything is like this, and we're so genius at it. We're brilliant. We've got heads of millions of concepts, all these mathematical, the science, all the engineering, all the architecture. All of it has come from the mind. All of it is knowledge we have plucked out of thin air and put into words and then use these laws to build buildings and computers. We're geniuses at this. We're geniuses at it. It's all merely labeled. Everything's merely labeled. Everything is merely labeled. Finally, the meaning, I remember in one recent book I was reading about emptiness, you know, that Nagarjuna or somebody, I forget my source, I'm sorry, that the meaning of dependent arising, the meaning of emptiness, the meaning of something's being a dependent arising is that it's empty of conceptuality, of being posited by the mind. That's the subtlest meaning of dependent arising. There cannot be such a thing that exists that isn't imputed by the mind on its parts. Nothing. Nothing, nothing, nothing. Enlightenment exists like that. It is a name given to a state of omniscience, including bodhicitta. That state does exist conventionally. You worked really hard to become that. It is true. And you do function as an enlightened being. You benefit sentient beings. It's true. You prove it. Make sure there's no other valid cognition that contradicts it, so there is enlightened mind, but not from its own side, not inherently. See, our instinct is, if it does exist, it has to be inherent. So as soon as we see this, say this, we tend to get doubt. Well, how can enlightenment exist? Come on, it's just sort of just rubbish then. It's only in the mind, it's just rubbish. And wrong. Wrong. That's what we think in the materialist world, which is the opposite. We think if nothing has meaning if it's in the mind. Oh, it's only in the mind, we'll say. The opposite of what Buddha's saying. This is merely labelled, the subtlest level. It's all these other arguments we have to use, just sort of squeeze our brain, as Lama Yeshe puts it, to get us to see the truth. Yeah. So this is, as I said earlier this morning, we started talking about this, the emptiness of our mind is called the absolute Buddha, the ultimate Buddha nature. That's the actual, the way they do, you just have to learn these words, that's all. The absolute Buddha nature, the actual Buddha nature, literally, simply, is an equivalent of the term emptiness of my mind. And why? Because everything can exist because it's empty. Because it's empty. If it were inherent, it would be something that doesn't depend upon anything else for its existence. And that's what Buddha's arguing with. And that's the subtle point, because we don't think that. If something were inherent, it would be existing in dependence upon, could be causes and conditions, certainly parts, certainly, finally, the mind naming it that, buying into its being that. And it's within that. We agree it's that. We all buy into it's that. We sign the contract that it is that. We shake hands on it. We buy into that, so then I can say, I'm walking up the hill, and you know what I mean. Because we've created it. Give it meaning. I got punched on the nose today. We give it that meaning. So it's quite, in other words, we're quite sophisticated in how we think. We've got all this shorthand. I'm walking up a hill. You know exactly how to respond to that. I'm eating my lunch. She said she didn't love me. We know the history behind all of this. We've got all this packaging, all these novels written. Then we say the shorthand, she doesn't love me. And we know exactly what you mean, and we can buy into this. It's all dependent arising. It has no inherent meaning. This is why we can relabel things and change the definition if we want to. So this is why when Rinpoche wrote to the people in prison after they wrote to him, he would say things like, you know, it's just labelled prison. It's labelled bad. There's nothing inherent about being in prison that's bad. This is the point I'm saying. Which is shocking to us, because as soon as you say he's going to prison, it's devastating, hideous. The reputation, the feeling of it, the poverty, the lack of freedom, the shame, all the packaging we put into that simple phrase. So therefore, naturally, we think it's bad. So therefore, naturally, people in prison suffer because it's bad. But as Rinpoche says, you can change the name and you can change the label anytime you like. Now, you don't have to have, you know, Webster's Dictionary agreeing with you. They won't. But people think prison is bad, but you can decide it's good. And many of my friends in prison who practice, they think it's good. So their mind changes because they label it good. As Rinpoche said, some Tibetans spend years trying to find some little ugly dark hole somewhere where they can stay on their own. They love it. They found, you know, one of my friends, a Western American, has spent 30 years trying to find the right place to go meditate on her own, lonely, and on her own, a little dark ugly hole. She was blissed out. So it proves being in a little ugly hole where you can't leave can't be bad in its nature. It's only bad because we've called it that because of all the rules and laws of samsara. But not in its nature. It can't be. You can just change it overnight, right there. You can say it's good. So suddenly what will happen? You'll feel happy. Well, so cheap and easy to be happy, so just change your mind. That's all Buddha's saying. That's all Buddha's saying. Change your mind, baby, and you'll get happy. We know, no, you've got to let the prison out. You've got to tell everybody I didn't do it. You've got to have it all written up in big posters around the world. Robina actually didn't do it. She's a good person. Then I think I might get better. Buddha says, much quicker than that. Change your thoughts. Right there. That's why the more advanced stages of practice of changing your mind are called transforming problems. Learning to like problems like we like ice cream, as Buddha says. Changing all the fundamental assumptions in the bones of our being about what happiness is and what suffering is and what causes it. It's a radical way to smash all the wrong assumptions, you know. So why? What's the logic here? Why is having a problem good? So by definition, now with samsaric definitions, and still conventional, it's true, a problem is where is something that you don't like. A problem is what attachment doesn't want. A problem is a thing that aversion responds to and freaks out about and sees as bad. That's our current definitions. That's our habit. And it's both in the bones of our being. So we believe it instantly because all the assumptions in us want it to be nice and we get bad instead. So changing our labelling of this is stupendous. So why is it good? What's the Buddhist logic for someone being mean to you being good? Very simple. Your job is trying to get rid of attachment. If that's your job, then being insulted is good. Getting attachment, not getting what it wants, is good by definition. Of course, the materialist world, as Milarepa says, whatever the world does is opposite to Dharma. The world wants cakes and nice things and praise. So the Dharma one, we want to smash that assumption, which is called attachment. So obviously you rejoice when you get the opposite. It's very logical. Then quickly, smash ego. Very reasonable. So nothing that exists, if it exists, could possibly have exist inherently. It's just to get our heads around this, get used to this thinking. It's rigorous thinking. By understanding even simply that inherent means not interdependent. It means not dependent arising. It means frozen in space, set in stone, unmoving, unchanging. And nothing can exist like that. And the point the Buddha's making is this ignorance in us is believing in that, believing in inherent I. That's the terms he gives for our disease. Like if you just know you've got a pain in your nose, you don't know what it's called, but the doctors will say that you've got the oopsie-daisy disease, you know. You didn't know it was called oopsie-daisy. You just know you've got a pain in your nose. Well, he knows the name of it. Well, Buddha calls the name of the disease grasping at inherent me. Oh, yeah? Really? That's what it's called? Thanks a lot. We have to then understand how it functions, understand its causes and conditions, you know, understand what it means. Yeah. So the more advanced levels of it, we read it in the 8 verses of mind training, the second, the last verse there, where it says to see everything as illusory and as a way of smashing attachment, you know. Or to see, you know, so... This is, again, why in the Lam Rim, emptiness, which itself is a Hinayana teaching, actually is taught in the context of the Mahayana component, coming along with bodhicitta, because it's the combination of bodhicitta and seeing the emptiness of the I. The combination of these is what Buddhahood is. The emptiness we're going to see if we don't involve the bodhicitta is still emptiness, but it's less powerful. You've still got some, you know, even though you're out of samsara, there's still pollution there. So they say that all the Hinayana arhats zap off to the pure land, zap off to the subtle state of bliss. This is the Mahayana interpretation. The Hinayana say they disappear altogether. No, Buddha says, they go into a state of bliss and they stay there for eons. And then Buddha comes along and taps them on the shoulder and says, okay, baby, get off, come onto the Mahayana path now, become a Buddha, stop wasting time, you know. So then they complete the path and become an enlightened being. So the added component is this incredible, great compassion of the Bodhisattva. Did we talk about that here or someone else? We didn't talk about it here, did we? Okay, so let's talk about the Mahayana component of the path. We've talked about the Hinayana up till now. So basically you're continuing to work from junior school, high school, you can just continue to progress on your path incrementally, step by step, and that job is you're continuing to purify your mind, basically. You're continuing to rip out of your mind the misconceptions. But here the emphasis is different. We shift gear here. Up till now, we're controlling our body and our speech and our mind. It's the practice of the morality of restraint, is what they call the first stages of the path, which is all the Hinayana component. The practice of the morality of restraint. This is why the monk up in the mountains is the ideal manifestation of this level of practice, which is the image of the monk, the Buddha, as the monk. He's the manifestation of this level of practice. So it's the morality of restraint. It's like a cautious level of practice. It's like not harming others. Don't harm, don't this, don't that, control your mind. It's all about restraint. So now the logic being you've harnessed this energy of your body, speech and mind to a pretty amazing degree. So now you can keep bopping on this path and move into the compassion wing where now you come out of the mountains and now you join all the crazies, you know, samsaric sentient beings, all the mad ones who normally make you crazy and cause you to, who are catalysts for your negative karma. But you're so stable now. You can be among the crazies without going berserk because your mind's so stable, your body and speech are so subdued. But you continue to work on your mind, you continue to rip out the delusions, but the emphasis here is more on the obstacle being called self-cherishing, which is an equivalent, a sweet term actually, for what we would call selfishness. A friend of mine heard about a course on self-cherishing. She thought, oh, wonderful, I must go there. I'd love to cherish myself. She was quite surprised when she heard it was a naughty thing, you know. So selfishness is the term we know, which basically means putting self first. So strictly speaking here, the logic of Buddhist psychology is the same. The root delusion is ego grasping, known colloquially, which is this ignorance that believes primordially in the inherent me, which then gives rise to the main delusion effectively in daily life, which is called attachment to what I want. Panic-stricken and neurotic every microsecond. The millisecond it doesn't get what it wants, that's called anger. It gives rise to jealousy and depression, all the other variations, okay? That's the way of talking in the compassion, in wisdom wing. The nuts and bolts of Buddhist psychology. Here, the talk is of trying to smash self-cherishing. So putting self first, obviously the reference point is others here. And we're trying to make this paradigm shift in this marvellous genre of practices coming from Shantideva into Tibet, which the Kadampa masters perfected, which Atisha got when he went to his guru in Salimpa on a 13-month boat journey. He got all these teachings, which they kept secret, that were so profound. The teachings of Lojong, mind training, which is just another word for what the Dharma is anyway, but this specific approach of transforming the mind from cherishing self to make this paradigm shift to cherish others, putting others first, exchanging self for others. This is the key, marvellous, most radical practice in Tibet, practiced by all the great masters coming from this lineage, from Atisha, Shantideva, through to Atisha, whose students, the Kadampa masters, brought it into Tibet. And it was kept secret for hundreds of years because it's such an outrageous teaching. Outrageous. So whole emphasis here, on the one side, you're continuing to purify your mind, you continue to rip out all the crazy roommates, argue with them, but the emphasis, the reference point here is the goal of exchanging self for others. So the enemy is called selfishness. Of course the root enemy is always ignorance and the root problem is attachment, but this is a particular offshoot of that. Therefore I put me first. So this is talked about all the way through. It's the reference point for each of the practices as the one that's trying to be annihilated. And the conclusion is, therefore, of course, one makes the paradigm shift and now one exchanges self for others. One cherishes others most. So it's this whole way of practicing that's been developed over the centuries in Tibet. And this is the technique that all the great masters that we know have practiced, have perfected. It's the more radical way of accomplishing love and compassion, great compassion, bodhicitta, etc., exchanging self for others. So there's various techniques, as we know from the Lamrim. There's a seven-point cause and effect, blah, 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 and there's this, the exchanging self for others. But this way that Pabongka Rinpoche in Liberation in the Palm of Your Hand presents it is this practice of combining these two tracks of practice to accomplish love and compassion and bodhicitta. And it's a combination, 11 steps that you go through, that is the combination of these two tracks, the last few of which are the practices from the exchanging self for others technique, the first few of which are for the other ones, the 7 point something or other, whatever it's called. So the first step in these, and again, these are all incremental, they're step by baby step. Don't confuse each of these steps. Each is quite specific. So the first one is called equanimity, and like a lot of these words, it's the name used to refer to the goal of this meditation, of this thinking process. So what equanimity is, such that when you've got it, and it's a specific definition here, it's not the equanimity they talk about in the Hinayana path, it's the equanimity that is a heartfelt recognition, when you've got it, right? We haven't got it yet, we've got to practice. The heartfelt recognition that enemy, friend and stranger, the three categories of sentient beings, the objects of attachment, aversion and ignorance. There's no fourth category, okay? That enemy, friend and stranger, simple, what equanimity is, it's the recognition when you've got it that they're equal from one, really, or maybe two points of view. Their wish to be happy, their wish not to suffer. This is what equanimity is. It's not love, compassion yet, it's not all that stuff. You've got to each step of the way, get each realization, each one leads incrementally to the next, incrementally to the next. It's a really logical, psychological progression. And how do you accomplish this? Again, you think it through. You use millions of examples to break down ego's ridiculous misconceptions. So, okay, millions of arguments we can use here. We'll just chat away about it, you know? So here, as we're even talking, let's imagine right in front of us a person we don't like, person who's been, even, it could be right now, person who's mean to us. We might use the word enemy, but it's simply a word we can use to refer to the person for whom we have aversion, which is the person who's harmed us, basically. Or just the person we don't like. Maybe they just irritate us. Maybe no one's harming us badly right now, but sure, we can all think of somebody in our life. And maybe especially if we haven't forgiven them. It's really helpful. Enemy, right there, eyeball to eyeball. To your left in front of you, you visualize a friend. What's a friend? By definition, a person who does what your attachment wants. And then the right is the stranger. And who's that? Well, that's one who's done neither. Very simple. And how do you feel about them? Couldn't care less. They could all drop dead. As long as I don't make an unbalance of the earth, I'm happy. You know, this reminds me, when I was looking at my iPad, it's not here now, my iPad, and I read the New York Times. And, you know, they have on the stories a brief heading and then a story, and then you press, click it, and you get the big story. Well, I saw in the right-hand corner, out of the corner of my eye, a story called 356 or something people die in ferry accident in Tasmania. Of course, Tasmania is my people, isn't it? You understand? And I go, oh, my God, and I look at the story, and then it goes, then I read, it says 356 people die in a ferry accident in Tanzania. So I go, oh, well, okay. Because why? They're strangers for me. Who knows a Tanzanian? I don't. Tanzania could fall off the face of the earth. Think about it. I'm being exaggerated. Get my point. That doesn't affect my life, Tanzania, does it? They're not my neighbours. They're not my friends. They're not my enemies. They're strangers. And let's face it, that's 99.9999% of the universe. Couldn't care less about them because they don't touch me. I mean, it's sort of embarrassing to think about it, but this is how we are. They've got a few enemies who loom large in our life, even bigger than the friends half the time. We never stop thinking about them. You might as well be attached to them, the way we think about them. Big and huge and vast, you know. Massive, evil, horrible, so righteous about it. That's why we want to get off and start foundations. You know, when you're not being horrible here, but listen. When your daughter gets murdered, You want to start foundations for stopping children getting murdered, don't you? But before that, there were children being murdered every day. You couldn't kill us because it wasn't yours. I'm sorry, but it's all like this. It's how we are, you know. So embarrassing when we think about how we look at the universe. And this is sentient beings. Giraffes have friends, enemies, strangers. Ants have friends, enemies, strangers. Mexican gangsters have friends, enemies, strangers. Believe me, they have them. My people and your people and all the rest. George Bush, and not George Bush anymore, whoever the naughty person is these days that we'd love to hate. I mean, I don't mind. George Bush is fine, you know. Remember Dalai Lama saying, he's a very nice man, but I'm not sure about his policies. And I'm sure that's true, you know, whatever. It's whatever your taste is, isn't it? So, you know, and then friend, what's that? You know, of course, it's the person we, you know, we have attachment to because they do what they satisfy my attachment. So, of course, we know that the friend one day can be the enemy the next. We know that, but forget that. So don't use the same person. Use a different person. So how do you argue with this? How do you come to this heartfelt recognition that they're equal? Well, there's a multitude of ways. I'm just talking about intellectually here. You use as many techniques as you can. It's not rocket science. This stuff, intellectually, is easier than emptiness, although emotionally harder to get. Okay, so what's one of the first things to recognise with equanimity is that we don't have any objectivity. We define every person on this earth in terms of what they do or don't for me. It's sort of really embarrassing to admit it, but it's true, isn't it? It's so true, it's so hilarious. So straight away, right there, that's enough proof. Right there is enough proof to show they're not inherent friend, enemy, stranger, which of course is how we think of them. We don't think we think they're inherent, but it's absolute conviction because Fred left me. He is in the enemy category. My heart is breaking. I think about him daily. I want to kill him. I want that woman to leave him and make him suffer like I did. I have jealousy, I have anger, I have hurt. He's in my mind all the time. My thoughts are obsessive. And it's one person of 7 billion humans, not to mention trillions of sentient beings. Look how he looms so large. Logical reason, because he harmed not my next door neighbour, not the people in Tanzania. Little baby me. It really is embarrassing. You've got to admit it's embarrassing. This is the view of the world, isn't it? So one of the first things I think you can say that we're trying to do in this meditation is get out of the equation. Move yourself out of the equation. Step back from it. And have the enemy, friend, and friend, enemy, and stranger there, like you're watching a movie, you know? And you put their faces there, you know them. The stranger there, a person whose face you know enough but have no feelings for them. And then what we're trying, we finally get out of the equation here. What we're attempting to do, like I'm doing already, is using logical reasons to prove that actually, from the point of view of the wish to be happy, they are the same. Now, we're not trying to love them yet, which is may you be happy. That comes four steps on. We're setting the foundation here. The foundation is the recognition that they wish to be happy. And this sounds weird to us. We don't think like this, but this is almost like a starting point for Buddha's teachings. This simple recognition that all sentient beings want to be happy. That's what equanimity is. So it's we're way to go to even get to that, right? We intellectually might see it's true, but the real point is when we think of the enemy, we think, what do you mean he wants to be happy? He doesn't deserve it. To even go there is too scary for us. Because the second you even say the words, it's true, Fred must want to be happy, that's why he left me. I'm no loaded there. He left me because he really believed he'd be happy with Mary. So we don't, but we just can't bear that thought. It's like taking our heart and chewing it and giving it to the lion. So we've got to be so brave to think these thoughts. Are you hearing me? These meditations, you're using logic to argue with ego's really entrenched views and thick assumptions about what's right and wrong. It's so painful to think this. But what we're getting to here is the courage to see the fact that it's true. Now, one really good argument I use for my mind to prove it's true, that any friend and stranger are equal in their wish to be happy, is that I reverse the picture. I think these three people, but I think that they're looking at me, each of them, so that when the friend looks at me, I see that, you know, my latest boyfriend, since Fred left me, say Joe, Joe's looking at me kind of starry-eyed, and I can go, oh yeah, he's seeing a friend there, he sees divine Robina, doesn't he? Then Fred's looking at me and he's seeing daggers, I can see the daggers, he hates me, he sees this ugly old person that he left for the gorgeous new one. Then you see the stranger looking so bored at me. Who's that? They see nothing because I'm neither enemy nor friend. I've neither harmed nor helped them, have I? So the friend is all excited. The enemy looks, hates me, and the stranger's bored. But look at yourself now. One minute I'm a friend, next second I'm a stranger, next second I'm an enemy. You with me, aren't you? Aren't I? But I want to be, I'm the same every moment, aren't I? So when Fred looks at me and I look evil to him, I want to be happy. I'm this little Robina here, my heart beating, dying to be loved, want to be happy. Oh, I want to be happy, Fred. It's true. When Joe looks at me, the same, oh, I want to be happy, want to be happy. When stranger looks at this boring person, I'm little, you know, all little perky, wanting to be happy still. So I'm the same in each case. Well, reverse it, so are they. It's so simple. This should be enough logic for us to get it. It's logical. It's just that we don't want to think it. So to have the courage, think of the person who's harmed you, who's criticising you at work, who's left you behind, who's mean to you, and all the anger, the hurt that's rising in our mind. Get past that and just think now. Well, you know, Robina, she really wants to be happy. She just feels like your beloved friend whom you know wants to be happy. So the instant you can even say those words, your heart softens. Because if you to think that a person wants to be happy, you have to acknowledge they're a human with a beating heart. So we can see it's quite powerful, difficult. There's lots of logical reasons you can do to break down these conceptions in our mind. And slowly, slowly, this realization that they're equal in their wish to be happy and not to suffer becomes as stable as a rock. So already, before you've begun to even think of the mother and the kindness and repaying the kindness and self-cherishing and love and compassion and tonglen and bodhicitta, before any of that, which we're starting with, already this is profound. Already this is incredible. Just equanimity. Just bare bones fact. All these creeps and crawlies, all the psychos, all the torturers, all the Hitlers, all the whoever you hate, all the evildoers in the world, who we love to hate. They're deluded, no doubt about it. They're maniacs, they are psychos. But they want to be happy. The python who would eat you if you got too close wants to be happy. So it's just a simple recognition, bare bones, simple. They wish to be happy. Hear the words. So why that one? Because that's the basis of love, which we're slowly moving to. That's the basis. Because love is, may you be happy. So right now we do have that for our friend, as Lama Zopa says, but it's really unstable. We do have, may you be happy, that's love, but for one group only, the friends who do my attachment wants. My attachment pollutes it. As we'd say, it's got strings attached. So we do know what love is, and that's coming 6 points later, 5 points later. So right now we do have love, but only for those who do what my attachment wants. And it's unstable. Look at the logic. Look at the logic. I say, I love you, Joe. Why do I love Joe? Excuse me. I might think he's got good qualities. He's kind to me. Not to the next door neighbour, not to his ex-wife. I don't mind. He's kind to me. He comes home abusing his ugly secretary. He's so stupid. I agree with him because she must be stupid. If Joe thinks she's stupid, she must be stupid. I don't mind that he's mean to her as long as he's kind to me. The attachment like this junky vampire, you know. So I do think I know he wants to be happy. And because he's attached to me and I'm attached to him, I want him to be happy so badly. But look what happens when Joe leaves me. Look at the picture. So it's obvious my love is unstable. It has no feet on it. It has no foundation. It has no base. It has no valid basis. So what Buddha's really saying is that the way I love Joe now, which is true, I do want him to be happy. It's unstable because it's based on the wrong reason. That is, the real reason to love Joe, which is 5 steps later, is because he wants to be happy. So when I accept that, then I think to myself, even as my training, I think, you think, if you've got Joe at home, you love Joe, Joe's so divine, you're dying for him to love you, you know he's happy, you want him to be happy, you help him be happy. but because you're attached to him. So the really scary thing to say is, may he be happy even if he leave me. You know? So then it begin, you could test that it's stable now. Because once you've got the logic, which is equanimity, he wants to be happy, then nothing will change. And therefore, of course, that includes the enemies and the strangers too. Because we've proven in equanimity they all want to be happy. So it needs to think about, and it's using logic. Because delusions, you see, have no logic. They're hysterical, they're emotional, they're neurotic, they're delusional, they're liars, and they're frantic. And they're the basis for our decisions right now. So in other words, Buddha's sort of saying, Robina, just because Fred is mean to you is no reason not to want him to be happy. This is love coming. I'm jumping ahead here. It's shocking to say that. It's outrageous to say that. Why? Because the logic we use now for loving Fred is only if he makes me happy. It's true. It's look at it. We know we can change this, but look at the default mode. So we're trying to rip out this assumption because it's a wrong reason. So the right reason, the logical reason, the foundation is they all want to be happy and they're equal to each other in that wish. It's very reasonable. You can prove it intellectually. But we just don't want to. So when it's a really stable realization, then we're incredible, already incredible. So then we make a lot of mistakes. So we think, oh, well, if they're all equal in their wish to be happy, then why don't I go and live with Angela down the street. I can live with Angelo. Why not? That's not the point. You've got karmic history with people. You won't meet those strangers. You won't see them for countless lives. You've known them all in the past, but in this particular life, they're strangers. So it's silly to go and move in with a stranger. Knock, knock, knock. Can I come in with you, please, because you're all equal? Excuse me, back off. I've got my own kids. Get out of the way. It's true. It's silly to go and think you should do that. That's not the consequence of equanimity. That you don't have to go live with Fred again, if he'd have you even. Bodhisattvas would rather live with an enemy. They'd rather be abused than be kind to because they don't want to waste their merit, you know. So we're not like that, so we better stick with Joe. So it means you've got some history with Joe. But we all know it could go up and you can love more, it can go down, you turn to enemies and nightmares. Look at the world, look at relationships. So we've got some history with Joe, so we've got to work that history out. So make it useful. Give up attachment to him, you know. See he wants to be happy, want him to be happy for his sake. That then makes the relationship useful. So stick with Joe, it's okay. But in your mind, when you think of Fred, you're not insane anymore. You've just subdued that rage because you do know he's a human being like everybody else and he wants to be happy. And anyway, due to your karma, he left you, so don't blame him, you know. All that comes before. Remember, all the wisdom teachings are all coming before. They're all informing these next stages of our practice. Equanimity. Pretty incredible already. So this gives rise to the next little technique in this series of 11, which is so quaint and so ridiculous. And you don't need to meditate on this one. You just get your calculator. It says all beings have been your mum. Well, first we think they're trying to torture us here because we think our mums are terrible. So all beings have tortured me before. What am I supposed to think here? No, wrong view. We then go to the next point. And it's logical. If there are countless minds, if they're all beginningless, we've all bumped into each other countless times. Actually, as mad as it sounds. But the point here, the reference point here is the mother. Why? Because, you know, this old-fashioned idea in Asia that the mother's the person who's nourished you and nurtured you and taken care of you. That's why. As His Holiness says politely to us Westerners, well, think of somebody else who's been kind to you. You don't have to think of your mother if you don't want to. Gives us nervous breakdown. So all beings have been my mum. It's just a logical view that expands yourself insanely limitlessly to think of all sentient beings. Gives rise to the next little contemplation, all mother is kind. So obviously, the deduction here is if mother's been kind, they've all been mothers, they've all been kind. So then you leap into the next one, which is I must repay their kindness. But let's look at the mother is kind. I find we need to do some very interesting thinking there. So first of all, I think it's our view of kindness that's our big stumbling block here. We always assume the word she is kind. Either we can use it in general. We see a person who helps somebody and we'll go, oh, she's so kind. We can mean it this way. But usually, when we mean it in relation to ourself, the only person who is kind to me is a person who does what my attachment wants. Think about it. So that's why we hate our mothers. Because at some point, and I remember the day she fell off the pedestal, I was stunned. I must have been about 12. Now you're sort of 3 years old, you're rejecting your mother, aren't you? You want to sue her and everything. Degenerate times. But I remember vividly the moment I first started to find fault in my mother. It was such a shock, I'll never forget it. Maybe I was 11, I can't remember. I was really stunned, I recall it. I was shocked. I'd never found fault in my mother before that. I remember it vividly. It was shocking, shocking. Well, then it was downhill after that, wasn't it? You know, it didn't take me long to open the floodgates. Started thinking her as the worst person in the world and the cause of all my suffering, and how dare she this, and she's attached, and she's this, and she's depressed, and she should have left my father, and how did she let my father do all those terrible things to us, and she's evil, and she's this, and she doesn't do that, and she leaves us at school just 4 hours until 7 p.m. at night, and why didn't she pick us up? And she's endless, constant, non-stop criticizing. Because anger is the response when attachment doesn't get what it wants. So the mother became the new one for us. And that's a common way we are. And I think that's reinforced very nicely in our culture, because we assume our mother is our creator, that we've got her qualities and she's responsible. And we all have this very naive, and it's quite stunning and quite shocking, expectation that for some reason, because she's my mother, she's supposed to be perfect, which is why I was so shocked to discover that she wasn't. It's very interesting, isn't it? So, of course, Buddha says, she didn't make you, Robina. Don't be ridiculous. She's lying there with your father, minding her own business, and you come and stick your nose in. You're the blame baby, not her. So it's already, with the Buddha's view of karma and all these things, you've got a very different set of assumptions here. So the first thing I'm saying is that we think kind means kind to me, which means they do what my attachment wants. So if I go to the cafe, you know, and they're busy, and the waitress comes up and smiles at me and takes my order, and then comes back. Well, like last night at the Japanese restaurant, I went out with Kate, and then I asked for some green tea ice cream. I wanted 2 scoops. Well, for some reason, she came back with 3 big scoops and a great big glob of cream, which I adore, of course. So, of course, I said, oh, you're so kind. I said straight away. She suddenly looked so kind to me. She was so, and it was sweet, you can hear. It was nice that she should take care of me and give me 3 scoops. I didn't ask for 3, I asked for 2. But she was generous, whatever reason. So of course you say, she's so kind. But if she only came back with 1 scoop, excuse me, you understand? Or if for some reason the person made lousy chocolate cake, she didn't make it, she's just the waitress. But she comes back with this lousy piece of chocolate cake because the cook didn't make a good piece. I'm going to think she's mean. Of course I will, because my attachment didn't get what it wanted. So I think we have to change that assumption first. So the meaning of kind here isn't even the same as saying, oh, look at that kind person helping that person. It's another meaning, and we're not used to this, and we don't like it much. And it's hard to hear it. What it means is, okay, it means she's done some good things. In another meditation we're going to do, after this one, which is that they say is even more marvelous, but seems initially more abstract, which I'll talk about in a moment. Here, though, it seems peculiar, but I think the practical thing is, of course our mother's done mean things to us. First of all, because she's in samsara like you. Join the club. So your expectation that she shouldn't do bad things is your mistake, not that she does bad things. Like you're saying, you think you should have been better. Your name, what's your name, darling?
Bridget.
Bridget thinks she should have done better, therefore she's disappointed. The assumption that you should be better is the problem, not that you didn't do better. Are you with me here? And that's a crucial part with all of us about practice. So our misconception here is the assumption that mother should only do things good for me. That's the mistake. The mistake is your attachment. That's all, not her mistake. So she's in samsara like you and me. So that means she does make mistakes. So that we have to accept that she does. But this is the problem, isn't it? Because delusions, their function, their main function is to exaggerate, to embellish something. So anger, in this case, which is thwarted attachment, embellishes the ugliness of our mother, which means we paint the whole of mother with the bad things. We only remember the bad things. They take the whole picture becomes those, which means we forget the good things, don't we? Fred loved me for 25 years, but he left me. One action in our history. Mm-hmm. And suddenly all that good has gone. I remember none of it. I refuse to remember it. I don't want to remember it. I can't remember it. I can only remember the one bad thing. And that could even just be a friend you've got for years and years, and they say one mean word and you never forgive them. Because now they are evil. So it's clearly an exaggeration, isn't it? Delusions exaggerate, and the same with attachment. When you're attached to something, you're only seeing all the pretty nice things. You're glossing over the situation, the person, the cake, Fred. You're glossing it over. Attachment starry-eyed and making it look divine. It isn't an accurate picture, is the point. So then with the mother, of course she did bad things. Yes, my mother's depressed, she was this, she was that, she didn't do this, which she should have done. She was a lousy housekeeper. So many things she did wrong. It's a fact. It's okay. But the point is here to simply recall the good things that your mother has done. So simple. So, let's say your mother gave you away. You'll say, I have no reason to thank my mother. Well, you are totally mistaken. You should be in tears of joy every day, because guess what? She didn't kill you. Lots of mothers abort their babies. I did. I always use the story. I'm always scared my sister will find out about it. She doesn't listen to my teachings, so she won't, hopefully. But my sister Judy, there were many of us, and me and my sister Jan and Polly, we all had abortions, right? And we said to Judy, she was 16 or something in the 60s, Judy, come on, it's all right, have an abortion, it's easy. She refused to have an abortion. She didn't want an abortion. She didn't want an abortion. She didn't want to kill the baby. So the baby came, and then she gave it away, you know, had it adopted. But then that child, I think, rejected her. Judy found her again when she was 20, but she came back into the family, but she rejected her. Whatever reasons, but probably mad at her for giving her away. Didn't forgive her, you know. But I happen to know Judy's motivation. She made a conscious decision not to kill her baby. That's incredible. If one person out there drags you from under a car and saves your life, you will never forget that person. You will love them till the day you die. Well, your mother didn't abort you. So please, that's a stunning reason to be grateful for her kindness. Whatever, incredible, incredible. She gave you a life, you know. This is the first reason. Forget the rest. But there must be, the fact that just, you know, even if she was a brutal mother, depressed, angry, neurotic, beat you, didn't clean the house, didn't do proper lunch, whatever. All of us, I'm meaning it. Horrible person, even. Still, there are things she's done. And this is such a really humbling exercise for our mind, I think. You know, kept you alive, fed you, wiped your little bottom, taught you how to tie shoelaces. Little baby things. Helped you become a civilized human being, you know. There's so many things to think. Can't argue with that, really. Then it's calming, right? Because then you get to have this affection. I must repay her kindness. Which is the next conclusion, next step. So the alternative, we're not going to have a tea break today, I'm sorry. No tea break, okay? Is that all right? Mm-hmm. Running out of time. So the next step, there's an alternative to this, which all the Lamas say is the most marvellous one, and it's actually based on interdependence. And it is that every sentient being is kind to you, every sentient being. And that initially seems very abstract, but it's really quite logical. It means, basically, that up until this moment in your life, every single thing from the first moment of conception that is a thing that has facilitated your life. That everything you have in your life, have had access to, which facilitates your life, is the handiwork of countless sentient beings. And in fact, not just that, but countless sentient beings have died. For example, we might not eat meat, but the vegetables that we eat, countless sentient beings have died in the growing and the nurturing and the harvesting and the driving and the selling and the cooking and everything of those vegetables. Because Buddha would say there's not an atom of space you won't find minds, sentient beings. So they're sentient beings who died. Of course, they didn't think about you when they were scurrying through the garden and got their little body cut in half by the digger. No, of course not. But that is a fact. It's a fact that sentient beings died or got sprayed or whatever, you know. And you get the carrots. There's one example. I think of, you know, my socks. I like navy blue knee-high socks, okay? Can't stand the ankle ones because your legs get cold with these silly skirts. So I like knee-high. I like them to be elasticized because they stay up instead of all the time pulling down. It's got to be navy blue. This is not too bad. It's a bit light, you know? But I like navy blue socks, knee-high socks. So that's my attachment wants that. So I go to the shops. I'll go to the Kmart. I'll go to this one. I'll go to Target. Best is to go to men's sock shops because men have kind of boring ones. Girls have dots and polka dots and stripes and weird things, you know. But we've got these in the girls' shop. $3.99. Somewhere. One of the cheap shops. Yeah, it was in Santa Fe. Okay, so I'm going searching for my long blue socks. One of those cheap shops, like, I can't remember, one of those shops, big chains in the malls, you know, cheap things. And there they were, $3.99. So, okay, I'm looking for my dark blue socks, right? I walk in the shop, and what's in my mind? I want my blue socks. That's overriding my mind. That's in the front of my mind. So all my searching is in reference to me getting what I want. So I'm prepared not to push people out of the way exactly, but if they're in my way, I'll get a bit impatient. You know, get to the socks. I'll see the packet. There it was on the little hanger. Well, then stop thinking. A person made that little hanger. Several people in a factory, someone designed that little hanger. Someone made it. Someone did the machine. Someone did the dye. Someone made the machine. Human beings. They weren't thinking about Robina. Of course they weren't. That's not the criterion of kindness. Not even that they're kind people. They might have been the local rapist. That's not the issue here. And this is where it's hard for us. What we're meaning by kind here is the simple bare fact that they did it at all. They did it at all. All scurrying around in the factory just to make the hanger. Then the cardboard with a little label on it and the name, you know. They were called knee socks, S-O-X, knee socks. Someone came up with that name. The little man and the little marketing company, the little socker, let's call them knee socks. Oh, good, Joe, well done. And they put knee socks on it and spell it with an X. And then someone typeset it. Well, Mr. Futura, you know, designed the type font back wherever. Someone typeset it on a little Mac, you know. Mary, there she was, type it. And then someone proofread it, make sure she put the X instead of the CKS. They're people. People you should be already weeping with gratitude. They're human beings. But for whose work you wouldn't have, I wouldn't know that they were knee-high socks. We chucked in with the carrots or something. But it was in the sock department. Well, Mrs. Fred came and put it in the sock department. And on the front, there's all the little signs and the thing and how much per pound. Well, that's the food, isn't it? Yeah, they do the food for that one. No nutritional value in the socks, okay. Someone designed the logo of Knee Socks Company. Someone did the typesetting of the little thing. These are knee socks made for, especially for girls, so the socks don't fall down. Exclamation mark. Someone thought up that little marketing line, you know. So the price, dollar sign. Someone did that. The price, decided, did all the working out, all the financials, and came up with $3.99 as a reasonable price. People did it. Every single bit of that is the handiwork of people. Real people like you and me with little beating hearts who want to be happy, don't want to suffer. It should be enough to make us weep in gratitude, like the always crying bodhisattva. Every time he thought of anything, he burst into tears because he thought of kindness of sentient beings. It's not a joke. This is all true. This is scientifically true. But whoever thinks about the sock people, who could care less? What I look at is, what a lousy looking font. I don't, I can't stand this. Future, I don't mind. But if it's an ugly looking font, oh, I don't like that Times Roman revolting old type. It's got the lousy English. They should have written it this way. Who put the comma there? That's wrong. Don't like the design. Don't like the font. Don't like the cardboard. Don't like the hanger. Don't like the pattern on my socks. These little triangles. It's not too bad. It's not a bit hidden, you see. Not bad. It's critical mind. Attachment mind. But I'm prepared to say thank you because the price was okay. So I got to the counter. Thank you very much, I said. When she smiled at me. As long as there's no line in front of me. So we're prepared to think, oh, that's good because the value is cheap. But we don't think of any one of those sentient beings who made those socks, who did the cardboard, did the hanger, did this, did that, who drove the socks from the sock factory, who mixed the cotton with the polyester, who put the elasticized stuff in it. The factories who created all this to help sentient beings keep their socks up. People in their little marketing rooms came up with a view of how to keep the socks up. And they're all excited because they know the people like me who want to keep their socks up. Think about what I'm saying. It's true. Is it not true? Is it not true? This is scientific truth. This is easier to see than emptiness, but harder to get to because whoever thinks it. Because all I care is I want my socks. All sentient beings are kind. This very body itself, the one thing we would say, come on, kindness, this is me, this is mine. Wrong. My mummy and daddy did a lot of puffing and panting to get that egg and sperm together. Thank you, very kind. Gave me a condition for my mind to zap into. And from there on, where is my body? It was my mother's egg and my father's sperm, excuse me. There's no my there. My mind came along, that's mine. Conjoined with their egg and their sperm. And then what happened? My mother started feeding herself with all the fishes. Well, she didn't eat many fish. Let's say she ate fishes and carrot, fishes and cows and bulls and chickens and things. So what is this food that turns into her body, turns into stuff, and guess what? It turns into my body. My body. My body. It's not. It's just a mountain of fishes and carrots and tomatoes and peanuts and fishes and chickens, isn't it? Where's my body? Excuse me. This is why. Kudisencha, I always mention this story. Rinpoche, when he's talked about some level of some bodhisattva, for whom the action of cutting off their hand to feed a starving animal is as inconsequential as a leaf falling off a tree. Well, that means this has to be beyond ego, has to realize emptiness. And phenomenal, all the way to love and compassion, great compassion, bodhicitta, done by Tonglen, exchanging self for others. So when they see a starving animal, and clearly there's no butcher shop open, they'd be stupid not to cut their hand off and just buy a pound of meat in the butcher. All they see is, that, you know, 145 pounds of meat. Oh, eat, please. Here, have the other one. Inconsequential as a leaf falling off a tree. So what does that mean technically? It means in their mind, there is the recognition that this is labelled Fred. Let's just say they're called Fred. And this is Fred's body. They know it's their body. They wouldn't take someone else's hand. That'd be quite rude. They know it's my body. But they have no attachment to it. No grasping at the eye. And having cultivated all these amazing meditations to perfection, all they see is suffering. And is unbearable. So their mind is full of incredible compassion. Full of cherishing others first. So of course, off comes the hand, and then the second and the other one as well, and why not the foot as well, you know? Eat up, please, until they're satisfied. And that's as inconsequential as a leaf falling off a tree for that mind. That's it. And which is pretty stunning, because we assume the absolute of my body and therefore pain. Not true. It's all to do with delusions. Because this body also is completely empty of existing from its own side. Not an atom of inherent existence. So the kindness of all sentient beings is already stupendous. We haven't got to love and compassion yet. We now want to repay their kindness. Oh my God. So then we do a couple of techniques, I'll dump through those, to, you know, logical analysis to break, this is now coming from the exchanging self for others genre of practices, that then get us to the essential technique called Tonglen, giving, taking. This is where we now, having primed our mind step by step, we now get to the essential technique that's in the eight verses. It's the seventh verse. I will secretly take upon myself their suffering and give them all my merit and all my happiness. And so the Tonglen practice has come out of that little text of Lungri Tungpa, the eight verses, an expression of self, of exchanging self for others. So this simple little practice, again, technically easy, but emotionally outrageous practice, done in a multitude of ways, but the essence of it is basically you visualize somebody with a headache, let's say. Actually, Prabhupada Rinpoche says, you do the practice in the morning. Well, you visualize yourself in the afternoon with a headache. And you practice taking upon yourself now your afternoon's headache. Start with yourself. Very helpful. Then you move to a friend. So you have this divine friend whom you utterly adore, and they've got a headache. So the meditation is like this. You're visualizing them with a headache, and you're cultivating the attitude of wishing to take upon yourself the headache, and then when you breathe in the yucky stuff, it cracks yourself, cherishing at your heart, like a little rock, for example, and then you breathe out blissful white light, and you give them all your lovely things. Essentially this, but let's break it down. Let's analyze the components. Well, first of all, we've got to be very clear here, this level of compassion and love in the Bodhisattva path. I mentioned this before. If you want to hear me on a hunt, okay, your Hinayana person on the path to achieve your own liberation, your Ahant. You become an enemy destroyer. You destroy the delusions, which means you've seen emptiness and you've perfected it, and now you've removed all the obscurations to your liberation, which is the path of the Pratimoksha, individual liberation. Let's say you've done that. Well, life after life after life after life after life, your motivation, your goal has been liberation from samsara. Liberation from samsara. Not Buddhahood. Liberation from samsara. That's been your goal. You've trained your mind to heading towards that, which is what renunciation gets you to. Exhausted by suffering. Got to get the hell out of samsara as quickly as possible. So naturally, as you progress, and in that life, as you get rid of all the delusions and you finally see emptiness and you've perfected it, let's say, you've achieved your liberation, whatever life that is, then obviously all you've got left in your mind is incredible love, incredible compassion, incredible kindness, incredible empathy. How can there not be? That's all there is left. But what happened? And you're blissful. So what happens then, though, because your motivation has programmed your mind, when you die, that motivation which you programmed your mind with, that wish to get out of samsara, overrides the compassion, and you zap into bliss. Now, you can be on the Mahayana path, and you've gone through these stages, and you're now into the Mahayana. Now, but your goal, even from practicing the Hinayana practices, your goal isn't liberation. Our goal is, may I become a Buddha to benefit all sentient beings. That's called bodhicitta. That's the goal. That's the goal. That's the programming we're putting into our mind. So you go through the same stages of realizations, let's say. And maybe you even realize emptiness and you've achieved your own liberation, let's just say. But your goal is Buddhahood. So when you die, your bodhicitta overrides the bliss, and you come back into another life, even if you don't need to. So that the main component here, which gave rise to the bodhicitta, is what they call great compassion. It's an extra component of compassion. This is really important to understand, and this is the unique characteristic of the compassion of the bodhisattva. Regular compassion, which is incredible already, is you see suffering and you have empathy for their pain. May you not suffer. You have this huge empathy, and you indeed will do what you can. Massive compassion, no question. But the bliss and your goal override that when you disappear and you zap into bliss. But if you're on the Mahayana path, not only do you have compassion, oh my God, look at that suffering, it's unbearable. You're cultivating, which gives rise to bodhicitta eventually, you're cultivating this component called great compassion. Great compassion. Which is, it's my job. What can I do to take it away? That's the unique one of the bodhisattva, and that's what we have to consciously speak. It's called great compassion. Not only is the suffering unbearable, but you actually take this incredible responsibility. You say, it's my job. What can I do to take it away? And that's exactly like the compassion of a mother. She has compassion as her child falls out of the car, nearly runs into the car. She can't believe the suffering, but she doesn't stand around wondering who's going to pull her kid out from under the car, even if she can't drive or anything. Even if she can't do anything, she's going to rush in there, even put herself under the car. Because she knows it's her job. She knows it's her job. That's the one we're trying to cultivate. And it's very courageous. They talk about the courage of the bodhisattva. Now, Tonglen is another piece on top. Even more outrageous. Just sort of indicated just there. You see the suffering. Oh my God, it's unbearable. What can I do to take it away? And then what Tonglen is this unique one, this very specific attitude. You know what? Rather me than you. Give me your suffering, I can handle it. That's Tonglen. That's Tonglen. Completely over the top. Now, let's look at what Tonglen isn't. It doesn't mean the goal is to get a headache. That's ridiculous. You're not sitting there breathing in going, I'm getting a headache. So then you fail because you flew, you didn't get a headache. That's not the point at all. It's not the issue. So secondly, this is not a method to heal that person of their headache. That's not the issue. That's not the point either. It's very simple. You are using the visualization of that person whom you do love, and even indeed when you get more advantage of your enemies as well, you're simply using them as a reference point for you to imagine that if I could, I would take upon myself their headache. because, well, you know what, I want them to be happy and I can't bear the thought that they're suffering and I'd rather have it than them. Rather you than me. Parents say this about their children. One of my friends in prison, Richie, years ago, I remember, this Mexican gangster, you know, killed several people. And he said when he sees his young friends, his people coming in, his people, the Mexicans, and he's been there 40 years, he's going to be there till the day he dies, 20 years, whatever, 30 years. And he said, when they come in, my heart breaks for them, my people. I wish I could take upon myself their suffering and they could be released, he said. That's a stupendous concept. That's stupendous. That's this incredible level of compassion that is the quickest method for kicking into bodhicitta, which says the suffering of others is unbearable. I must never stop helping them, and specifically, I must never stop working on myself so I can become a Buddha, because then I will be qualified. And all of this love, compassion, great passion, tonglen, this is the amazing techniques that one uses to kick this into place, the quickest method. So do you have any questions now? It's 25 to 4, and I'm sorry, it feels like I need a toilet break. Do you want a toilet break? Pee-pee break? Quick break? 5 minutes. We'll be sort of finished at about 4:15. It's 25 to 4. Do you want a break? Okay, go on.